can a building filled with mold and other biotoxins create the same symptoms as adrenal fatigue?
So mold is a stress in the bucket, right? It's only one of many, many stresses, and it's very common for people to chase after these various stressors that are in the bucket, whether it's heavy metals, chronic viruses or bacteria, you name it, right? Epstein-Barr, Lyme, parvo, CMV, but again, you know, mercury, things like that. These are a stressor in the bucket. Is it a good idea to live in a house with mold? No. Thing is, mold is everywhere, right? So why do some people go into a building and they react to mold, and other people go into that same building? It's not a problem. The problem is deeper. The problem is actually within us. Usually an immune system issue, and the immune system is hit with, when you hit the immune system with stress hormone, that's what it does. It becomes hyperreactive, right? What's got to happen to develop adrenal fatigue? It's got to be some bit of a genetic predisposition and just enough chronic stress of any kind to overwhelm those genetics, right? Could mold be one? Yes. But what I find is that that's only maybe the tip of the iceberg at best. There's more going on. So we got to pay attention to both the genetics and the other side of things as well.
Is there a correlation between adrenal fatigue and Helicobacter pylori?
So H. pylori is a bug. It's one of our trillions of bugs in our microbiome. H. pylori got a lot of press because they connected it to ulcers. You know, my take on that is that H. pylori is an opportunistic bug. Because if you test everybody's microbiome, there are plenty of people with H. pylori, and they've done this research, plenty of people who test positive for H. pylori but do not have an ulcer and do not have any GI problems at all. But if your physiology is shifted here, and now you're compromising immune digestive, so compromising your digestive system, now you can set somebody up for being vulnerable to either that bug in the gut or candida or enterobacter or all kinds of myriad dysbiotic bacteria. That's why most of my patients get diagnosed with IBS or irritable bowel syndrome. Can I say adrenal fatigue is causing your H. pylori? No. But if you're to go to look at the rest of the symptoms, and this is the key, most symptoms are not going to tell me you have adrenal fatigue, right? But if you look at the conglomeration of symptoms, right? So you have H. pylori, but do you have fatigue, pain, weight, brain fog, insomnia, anxiety, depression, blood sugar, blood pressure problems? Do you have other immune problems, ovarian hormone problems, thyroid problems, and some other things? If you have that combination, then chances are that H. pylori is an opportunistic because of this underlying problem. But you got to look at the rest of this stuff. I have on my website, we built an adrenal fatigue questionnaire, which kind of gives, you kind of just answer these quick questions, pretty simple to do, and it kind of spits out, you know, likelihood of adrenal issues.
How can I manage colds, coughs, phlegm, and low energy while also dealing with asthma triggered by stress? And I've upped my salt intake, but I still can't manage to drink enough water.
Again, it makes sense, right? So extra demand, it all goes into this bucket. Our whole life is in this bucket, right? That's the biggest thing, our whole life, past and present. Past trauma, abuse, childhood stuff, school, work, relationships, physical, mental, emotional stressors, and every to-do, responsibility, toxic exposure, argument, worry about bad news on TV, it's all in the same bucket. The way to move forward is to create space in the bucket, right? So you took on a bunch of stuff, bucket filled back up, your stress physiology suppressed your immune system, and there it goes, right? So, I mean, there's some immune supportive things you can take, but the key is to stop suppressing the immune system. For the immune system, you know, I start with some basics like D and C and zinc, those kinds of things, right? Those are important just from a basic immunologic protocol. You're mentioning you have asthma, and asthma is going to come from this too, believe it or not. The immune system is very predictable when we hit it with stress hormone. It goes through a shift, technically, I know this is a lot, but it's called a TH1 to TH2 shift. The TH2 side of that problem, so TH1 side means we don't fight infections well, so we're more susceptible. TH2 side means we create lots of antibodies to things. That leads to allergies, food, environment, asthma, things like that. It's a very predictable thing. We can try to fix that TH1 to TH2 shift, which we sometimes will, but if your stress physiology is constantly causing that shift, you know, that's going to be a problem. So there's a
And by the way, I should mention,
if any of y'all have any questions specific to your specific situation, you can always reach out to us. So ask the questions in the comments here, but you can also call. You can talk to one of my patient coordinators, and they can talk you through, you know, what your situation is. Complimentary, right? Complimentary call. Talk that through with somebody specifically, and they can help to kind of guide you into the right direction.